All righty. Good evening, everyone. I am Lauren Gates, your host of this evening's Airway Health Solutions Conversation Series with our very own Dr. Ben Miraglia. Welcome back, Dr. Ben. It's so good to see you. I know we had a little bit of a summer break here, so we're back in the swing of it, right?
Yeah. Terrific. Ready to get it rolling.
I know it feels like a long time, but it's good to be back in that. I'm glad we have a lot of people here registered. We have over 600 registered tonight, and it's a popular topic. The topic actually is airway dentistry, and we've titled it ages 3 to 99, because really there isn't any age that we can't help on some level. And I'm really excited about how you're going to share that with your cases that you've done, you know, over the last, you know, 20 to 30 years, depending on the case. But our focus here is the dental professional's role tonight in lifelong health. So I know it's one of your favorite topics, Dr. Ben, but why don't you give us a kind of an overview? We have a lot of new people here who perhaps aren't familiar with your work, about how you got started, and then I'm going to go ahead and kick off with a formal interview for those who don't know your academic background.
Yeah, totally. So it was a little over 20 years ago now. I'm 31 years into dentistry. And for 10 years, I did crown and bridge and implant reconstructive dentistry, fixed a lot of teeth, fixed a lot of mouths, the rehab that we do restoratively. And then over those 10 years, we were a family care practice. I was referring children out to ortho. And then, of course, you're getting them back. So all those kids going out, you're seeing them every 6 months, you're following along. And it just seemed I wasn't very impressed with the results or the progress. And so as you're paying attention to all of this, and then the years are going by and you're trying to have conversations, it wasn't going very well. And sure enough, between the poor bite, the TMD, the problems the kids were having, the extractions, all the stuff added up to frustration enough that about 10 years of that, I decided to do it myself. And that those were like my famous last words. It was the very last argument I had with an orthodontist locally. Was if that's the best it is, then fine, I'll do it myself. I remember hanging up the phone and thinking, oh, what did I just do? And then sure enough, I had to start finding classes, and there had to be an alternative to this, because it cannot be this is the best there is. And sure enough, you find the world of expansion orthodontics. Expansive orthodontics is out there to find. I did not invent it. And sure enough, it's been going on for decades. And I took every class I could that was expansive, early treatment, expansive techniques. Then you get involved in clear aligners and you see how capable those are. And one thing leads to another. Fast forward 21 years or two, maybe 22 now, years later, I have not extracted a single tooth in any human being that we've treated along the way. And the good news is that when you put the foundation first, grow the jaws early, play with the teeth second or later, you have a whole different pathway there. We're going to share a mixture today of kids from age 3 all the way up. And there's even one in there that is a what not to do when you get the wrong treatment right somewhere else. You might have a tiny problem to fix in there in that regard.
Interesting. I know Dr. Kotlow is with us tonight, and he actually typed in needs to be ages birth to 99, which we agree, but we're just talking about the dentition today, correct? We're going to talk about, so I know you agree birth, that's when you can really go ahead and look for all the frenum attachments and all that. But so I just want to clarify that we just said 3 to 99, just because we're going to focus on when you start with the teeth, because this is more of the dental professional's role. So we're all on the same page here. I'm going to go ahead and read your bio, because again, there are many people who haven't heard you, and this is the first time. So I just want to make sure we have a good background and we know what we're in store for tonight. Dr. Ben Miraglia graduated from the SUNY at Buffalo School of Dental Medicine. He has 31 years of general practice experience in Mount Kisco, including 21 years of interceptive orthopedic and orthodontic experience, where his focus has been on early childhood growth and development. Dr. Miraglia lectures nationally on sleep-related breathing disorders, clear aligner therapy, and cranial facial development. And Dr. Miraglia is the Chief Clinical Officer at Airway Health Solutions. He's the Chief Clinical Officer at Toothpillow, and he is the VP of GP Clinical Education at Candid Pro. He is on the board of directors of the American Academy of Physiological Medicine and Dentistry, and Dr. Miraglia has been recognized multiple times as a leader in continuing education by Dentistry Today magazine. So again, thank you so much for taking the time today. And I want to, on behalf of myself and our team, we want to extend a warm welcome to all of our attendees. We couldn't do this without you, and we're thrilled to have everyone tonight. As I mentioned, we have 640 registered for tonight's conversation, which is a nice testament and validation of the interest in our airway health movement. So thanks to all of you who are really, really, really comprehensive and really care about your patients and learning new things. So we welcome you. And I always like to see who's with us today. So I'm going to go ahead and have Jay, my assistant, he's going to go ahead and launch a poll for us to just see who is with us today, what professions, or maybe some parents even, and patients. You can scroll down too. Give it a moment. Growing. So welcome everyone. Here we have a kind of a smorgasbord of patients, and we have one parent, a patient. So welcome. We hope you learned tonight, and welcome everyone else, especially all of the dental team. That's what we're going to be focused on today. But again, this is a collaborative approach, but we will be focusing on the dental team's role for this specific webinar. So I'm so glad that the collaborative team is here as well, because it's really important to realize what the dental team can actually do when you do refer, or maybe you want to consider referring after you see this presentation. So just a couple of disclaimers and housekeeping items. The views presented are the opinions of our speaker and are not necessarily affiliated with Lauren Gates and Associates and Airway Health Solutions. And the following webinar is provided for educational informational purposes only, does not constitute providing medical advice or professional services. The information provided should not be used for diagnosing or treating a health problem or disease, and those seeking personal medical advice should consult with a licensed physician or dentist. Always seek the advice of your doctor or other qualified health provider regarding a medical or dental condition. And then also, we are really happy to offer free CE this evening, but to receive the CE certificate, you must be in attendance for the entire program. The Zoom software tracks attendance, so we do not need to give a code or a survey. It's just a report that we get, and you will get your CE certificate usually by Wednesday of next week. So I think that's all I have as far as house items go. Dr. Miraglia, why don't we kick it off? I know we have a really exciting evening planned.
Oh yeah, definitely. I'll share my screen. Let's see if I can get this right and get started on that first slide.
Yep.
Title slide come up. Okay, good. Terrific.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah. Those of you who have seen me before, good news. I did put in like half new cases. So we might cover 8 patients. I think 4 of them are new. So you'll have something new to see. And then the other 4, if you've seen me before, you might've seen them before, but it's still good to see it again. You can never know what you might learn second pass along. So we'll just get started. Here's a first patient. We'll begin with the age of about 3. And when they do come in early, you start learning that ear infections and grinding the teeth. Parents will talk about that right away. It turns out most kids come to the office and the parents will say, yeah, they're grinding their teeth. When we ask them to observe, they'll say there's mouth breathing. We see it now. It's day, it's night, it's both. And you know, we land that into the sleep disorder breathing category. If your mouth breathing were worse at night, you've got some sort of sleep disorder breathing to play with. And it's not uncommon to see a bite like this. So the teeth are together. The bite is deep. You can't see the bottom teeth. You know, this has the makings of the underdeveloped jaws. And with the underdeveloped jaws comes the crowding of teeth. We know from Dr. Bogue's research, this is going to grow up to be severe crowding. Basically, you don't outgrow early malocclusion. And so when you have something like this, lack of spacing in the primary teeth, deep bite, class 2-ish, the lower jaw is back. It'll be narrow as all the teeth are angled in. All of these credentials are going to pursue right through the mixed dentition to the permanent. And this child is a wonderful candidate at 3 years old for guidance appliances. So you've used a lot of guides over the last 2 decades. And this is just a little bit of progress. This is a few months later. So in a few months' time of wearing a guide for an hour a day plus overnight, it'll start to change the bite. It'll start showing you a difference. But we're going to use guides all the way through. And basically, as time passes, this child's going to start having the mixed dentition come in. So we might be 5 years old, then we might be 6 or 7 years old, and all of a sudden here come new teeth. But the entirety of the time, we're just using a guidance appliance 1 hour a day plus overnight, and the child graduates from one to the next as we go from primary to mixed dentition to permanent. But as the time is passing, basically, the child is growing up, they wear their guide an hour a day plus overnight, and slowly the teeth erupt, but fit in. And this child has above average tooth size, which is nice because in the beginning you had an amount of baby tooth crowding happening there. Whereas if your teeth are above average in size, you'd expect even more crowding. So the deep bite's kind of fading away. And as time is passing, the child's going all the way through into the 12-year-old where they have their permanent dentition. And even though they have above average tooth size, they have no crowding. They have a beautiful bite. They have a broad, wide arch with a shallow vault, plenty of room for the tongue. The child will be a nasal breather, sleeping through the night without symptoms. And then over time, you can learn from the parent, like, when did they have their last ear infection? And it turns out this child who began with age three having multiple ear infections was thinking about tubes as an option. And then once we got started and the guidance appliance can redirect the swallowing pattern, when you're swallowing correctly, you can start to have better drainage of the eustachian tube. As the fluid drains more properly, you get less infections. So basically, the child has their last ear infection about 3.5 years old. By 4, there are no more, no tubes. And from 4 to 12, you can have an 8-year run. So far, no ear infections. So you have a beautiful broad wide arch established without using expanders. There were no expanders used here. There were no braces used here. There were no aligners used here. This was just a guidance appliance alone, working our way from primary to mixed to permanent. The child would come in every 6 months in the recall chair for hygiene, and we would check them and, you know, basically do a profitable visit in the hygiene chair, but meanwhile, take a look at the guide and see if they're ready for a new one. The lower teeth all line up beautifully, and going from, you know, the first tooth beginning to erupt where there was no primary spacing into a fully aligned set of permanent teeth, you know, that child has little to no chance of this happening on its own. So if you could redirect early on, you can save that child a whole lot of trouble. And basically, you have an opportunity early to help that child to avoid the years of trying to unravel severe crowding in a smaller foundation. And meanwhile, it's less about the teeth and more about the foundation. You'd love to have the foundation growing nicely, get your breathing and musculature correct, have the right size jaw growth and development, and last but not least, have the teeth. That's just an example of all the teeth coming into position on their own and the child never needing anything more than the guide. Sometimes the children get close and then they need a little bit of something afterwards. We'll cover a little bit of that next. So we meet children who grind their teeth, and it's this child as well, but they come in here sometimes with a class 3 bite. And so if you're 3 or 3.5 years old and you're biting like this, you know, you just make sure that it's not postured forward. So of course we would go through all of the speech and positioning and talking with that child, playing with them long enough to know, ooh, that is not a posture forward bite. That is their bite. So sure enough, we have this class 3 early bite that is not going to unlock itself. So we would begin again, a guidance appliance. You know, we put a guidance appliance in there, use it for an hour a day plus overnight, and redirecting the breathing musculature changes the growth and direction of the jaws. So all of a sudden you get a lot more attention to the top. Both jaws are going to grow wider and forward over time. But 4 months later, we're here. 8 months later, we're already edge to edge. And then by the time we just see an 8-month difference, we can go from totally locked in to edge in just the first 8 months. And we probably started her at about 3.5. So here we are a little bit more than 4 years old. So by the time we're 4 plus a little, we're already unlocked, but we're going to take that child all the way through to their permanent dentition. So mixed dentition, we'll give them a new guide, and we'll keep working with the 1 hour a day plus overnight. And again, same thing here, no expanders, no brackets, no wires, no aligners. This is just a guide only all the way through. And as the mixed dentition is now, you know, moving along, the new teeth are coming in really close to where they belong. And again, the ages are just going by because you're seeing the child every 6 months in the hygiene chair. And slowly but surely, you can get all the way to the point where you have a completed case. You have a child who has a beautiful bite. All the teeth are in place. They don't need anything else. And you did it with a guidance appliance, you know, an hour a day plus overnight. That child can do this easily. It's the kind of simplest, most conservative way to, you know, guide a child's breathing, musculature, jaw growth and development into where you have the opportunity for the teeth and the bite to come together. And that class 3 bite being locked in like that is no fun to fix at the later ages. Anybody who wrestles with that later on, you know for sure how bad and tough those are. This is a nice, simple way, and this does not involve any any expanders, brackets, wires, or aligners. This is a really nice thing. And now we get to this question here, which you could think about for a second while we get into a couple of these kids here. What age can a child be prescribed ADHD medication? And some of you are aware and some are not, but basically we have this medication pathway for the symptoms that are called an attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And so we meet a lot of children who are young. They might be four. This is a four-year-old who is struggling with nightmares, bedwetting, waking at night, mouth breathing and snoring, restless sleep, lots of movement, constant drooling, fingers in the mouth, weekly tantrums, and preschool behavior from the school officials. Find a different school, don't come back, go get evaluated for ADHD. Of course, when you go get evaluated, you'll get kind of diagnosed and you'll be offered medication. So we have that pathway as one way to do it, which is treat the symptoms. But we might want to take a look in there and see where we are. And this child has a little spacing, but not enough. And when we're thinking about Dr. Bogue's research, he knew that you needed a significant gap between all those primary teeth, and you'd like to have the full bite showing the lower teeth. So this child is narrow and back and basically underdeveloped, leading to a bit of the breathing issues. Same thing, we're going to start this child off with a guidance appliance. This child is also going to the myofunctional therapist. So when we met this child, we recommended myofunctional therapy. We got them right into the office. And next thing you know, they're doing myofunctional therapy. We deliver the guidance appliance and we ask for an hour a day plus overnight. This is a change in 1 year's time. So 12 months later, we have a little more spacing, especially in the lower teeth there, and we have a change in the bite. So with the widening of the upper jaw, the lower can release forward. So in 1 year's time, we do see a difference in the symptoms. So those night terrors that were recorded at about once a week are now one per month, so decreasing. The bedwetting was every night is dry. That happened in the first few weeks. The waking at night was 3 to 4 nights a week, is now one per month. And then the mouth breathing, snoring went from most nights to rarely. The restless sleep and movements, the limb movements were most nights. It's now none, but one of the things we needed to do for this child was make a referral to the pediatrician as well to do blood work to test for the iron levels, specifically ferritin. It turns out that if your ferritin is low, you might have an association with limb movements. And the levels are weird because the normal ferritin for a child is 7 to 140. So they have this big range, 7 to 140. And if you test like 12, like he tested at a 12, 12 is between 7 and 140. So it kind of comes back normal, except in the sleep research, it does show that ferritin below 50 is a risk factor for limb movements. So he basically has an iron deficiency. So he does take a supplement to get him between 50 and 60. So they give him just the right amount. He takes a daily iron supplement. He gets between 50 and 60 for the ferritin. Now, all of a sudden, the limb movements decrease. The drooling disappears. The weekly tantrums stop. And all of that find a different school, don't come back, becomes the best student in the class. So 1 year later, he goes back to the same school and they say, we'd like to try again. We're agreeable. 2 weeks later, they get a phone call. Parents get the call. It happens quite a bit. The parent will get a call and the school will say, your child has been the best student this week, this month, whatever it might be. And thank you for getting them the medication they needed. Meanwhile, none of the children that we're getting a phone call for get medication. They basically get growth and development for breathing and sleeping as their treatment. We treat the cause instead of the symptom. Now, I don't treat ADHD. I just treat malocclusion. I do treat in my lane. So while these kids have these symptoms and diagnoses, we would never tell a parent we're treating their ADHD. We're treating these that list of symptoms. We're going to take the jaw growth and development and treat our malocclusion. So we have that growing appropriately. And with growing the jaws comes better breathing, comes better sleeping. So we're working our way from what we believe is the cause of these things and treating in our lane to help a child. But by the age of 8, all of a sudden we have a child who sleeps beautifully, performs in school at the highest level. He's considered the straight A student, whatever you call that today. I don't know if they're getting A's anymore. It's different today, but he's at the top of the class. As the new teeth are coming in, they'll come in where they belong. Again, this is myofunctional therapy, guidance appliances. He did need frenum release, so the lingual frenum was released. And sure enough, over time, he gets to 11, you have most of the teeth in. By the time he's 12, and I apologize for the blurry picture, I don't always take a great picture, but at age 12, he does have all the teeth in place, and he's never had an expander, never had brackets, never had wires, never had aligners. He's only had basically the myofunctional therapy with guidance appliances and a lingual frenum release as his main treatment. And the ferritin was the supplement, the iron supplement as well. And so this is a child who could benefit from early treatment. The earlier, the better. And he's a little bit older now. He's probably 13 or 14. He lives a very healthy life. And he is a near black belt in Taekwondo and a double black diamond skier as well. So he's been able to take the lessons that are necessary, which I would imagine requires lots of discipline to be able to become a double black diamond skier by the time you're 10 years old. I think he had already achieved that. So a nice healthy outcome for him. So we were thinking about this question, what age can a child be prescribed ADHD medication? And it turned out the kids coming to our office at age 4 were already being told you could go and get that. And so I started to dig a little bit. And when you're digging, you learn some stuff. And so it turns out that when you dig enough, you find that from the American Psychiatric Association, they report about 5% of kids have ADHD. But it was interesting back in 2013 that the CDC reported 11% of kids age 4 to 17 have ADHD, according to their records. So those are two big different numbers, 5% versus 11%. Back in 1990, there were 600,000 children medicated for ADHD, and that number jumped to 3.5 million in 2013. Well, it's gotten worse since then. So prescription sales have quintupled over the last decade, exceeding $9 billion in annual sales. So it's a $9 billion annual revenue for kids being medicated between 4 and 17 on ADHD protocols. That's a big number, $9 billion. So I just wanted to reset the thought on that, because for a second, I wasn't sure how many zeros that was. And I figured, oh, I may as well write it out. So I wrote down a million. I know what $1 million is. That's a lot of money, $1 million. But I multiplied that times 100 to get to 100 million. And you know, basically, I'm learning, well, I'm not even close. So once I got to 100 million, I had to do 10 times that. And 10 times that gets me to 1 billion. Hey, I finally got to $1 billion. But I had to multiply a million times 100, then 100 million times 10 to get to 1 billion. We still have to multiply that times 9 to get to $9 billion. And this is the 12-month. The annual revenue from ADHD medication for children between 4 and 17, that's incredible. I'll let you add up 2 and 2 on your own, see what you get. ADHD diagnosis. Well, it comes down to this. A child with 6 symptoms for 6 months, basically reported by 2 sources. So the 2 sources are typically school and parent, because that's who sees the child. And if you have a list, and one of them is a Connors test, but there's a list of symptoms, 20 to 25 symptoms, a parent fills out an exhausting questionnaire, so does the school. And it turns out when you have 6 symptoms for 6 months, that should say 4 6 months, 6 symptoms for 6 months reported by 2 sources, you have a confirmed diagnosis of ADHD. There isn't a blood test, a urine test, a brain scan. There's nothing other than a symptom list that is filled out. And it turns out when you've read through that symptom list, it looks a whole lot like a sleep deprivation list. If you were to ask someone who's a new parent for 6 or 12 weeks of bringing the baby home and having to take care of it around the clock, they would probably check off half of that list, having it for the time frame that they're up every other hour. So yeah, that list looks to me like a sleep deprivation checklist. So you dig a little further and it does get a little bit worse. It turns out that there was an article in the New York Times that I think they called it an expose to share about this, that 2 to 3 year olds were being medicated. And they learned that there were over 10,000 2 to 3 year olds medicated for ADHD back in 2014. So 10 years ago, we had already passed 10,000 2 to 3 year olds are medicated for ADHD. And of course, you know, that proves that it's, you know, worth it and it's a good thing to do. So it's gotten worse from there. And now you can dig and find that Medicaid data reported for 36 states that 1 to 2% of children aged younger than 4 years old are receiving psychotropic medication, and ADHD accounts for 61% of it. So 61% is the amount of medication in the children that are younger than 4 reported in 36 states. So we already have 36 states that are medicating 1 to 2% of the 2 and 3 year olds. That's incredible that 1 or 2 kids out of 100 in 36 states are getting medications, and 61% are in the ADHD category. So that is wild. And all you have to do is dig. It takes a bit of digging. None of this stuff is easy to come by. It's very hard to find this stuff. And that's because after 2013, they stopped reporting and recording all of it. I'll let you add 2 and 2, see where that leads you. But we do meet kids who are already taking medication. So here's a list of a child who's, I believe, going to be 10 years old when they get to us. And here we're going to find chronic mouth breathing, nasal congestion, multiple ear infections, and tubes, trouble falling asleep, waking every night, morning issues, school struggles, fatigue. Already has a diagnosis of mild obstructive sleep apnea, already has a diagnosis of ADHD, and is already medicated. So now we've got a child coming in with this struggle, and this list really dates back to age three. When you start to ask the parents the questionnaires, and when did this begin and when did that begin, it's very easy for them to remember because they know when they don't sleep and when it began. And they can tell you about their 2 and 3 year old struggling and that we've never really had a good night's sleep. And then, of course, this just gets worse over time. And we meet that child. And of course, we'll take some pictures. And so here we could see where, you know, her lips kind of land, but the smile kind of shows you, oh, that's not a bad bite. And we don't really see any crowding in this direction. So, you know, here's a nice example of it doesn't take a whole lot of crowding, really. It just takes underdeveloped jaws and bad numbers to make you a poor breather. And then we're going to help this child again with our, you know, diagnosis of underdeveloped jaws or malocclusion and treating her out. We take some imaging, and that's not the worst airway you've ever seen. In fact, that's a nice kind of two-dimensional view of the airway. It's a really nice one. So when I look at this, I see, ooh, that's a garden hose. So the longer you're in this, the more you recognize that that's a nice space, even in two dimensions. I know the jaws are growing forward. So she has forward growth. So I see a picture like this and automatically I know this is really a width issue. This child's going to come in narrow. She has no room for her tongue in there. So we're going to want to measure her width to see where she is. And then we can take a look at this picture and you can see, yep, gingivitis and plaque and stuff. And maybe there's a hygiene issue, but maybe not. I have switched my thought from these kids are bad brushers to these kids are mouth breathers predominantly. And so I feel like when you're seeing the plaque, the gingivitis and things like this, I don't know if it's really due to poor hygiene anymore. I think it might be the mouth breathing, number one. And then after that, maybe they want to brush their teeth as much as they should, but I would blame it on the mouth breathing first. So when we take our photos and measurements, we'll learn that, oh, her transverse measurement is 33 millimeters. Now, 33 millimeters is the distance in between her first molars. The upper permanent first molars are tooth number 3 and 14. So I love this measurement. We do it for every child. Well, every human that comes into the office gets measured, but the kids get measured certainly at any age they come in. Now, 3 to 14, right at the gum line in between those teeth, she's got 33 millimeters and she's 10 years old. And I'm thinking she really needs to be at 40. And 40 would be enough to have proper tongue space, but 40 would also be enough to have a proper nasal chamber, because we know the roof of the mouth is the floor of the nose. This is a little more vaulted than we'd like it to be. If this were wide open, you know, that nice expansion we're planning for her is going to give her a bigger nasal chamber and then more room for the tongue. This should go very well. So turns out she did have a sleep study and an ENT visit already. So we got the paperwork. We learned she was diagnosed with mild obstructive sleep apnea. She did go to the ENT and had a nasal scope, but their report said her adenoids were small. Her tonsils were only a 1 or 2, and she did not have a deviated septum. So all of a sudden we learned from the ENT, well, there's really no problem in the nasal chamber. So based on the CEPH, that lateral x-ray showing the forward movement, and you've got a nice tube two-dimensionally, the ENT clears the nasal chamber. I basically have reduced my little diagnosis to the width. And oh, no tongue tie. So I take a look at that. The myofunctional therapist takes a look at that. The ENT even said, we don't believe there's a tongue tie. So we didn't do a revision for her, but we did put her in expanders right away. And what you're looking at here is 8 millimeters. I have always used upper and lower. I don't have examples of using upper only. And so the amount of distance we need to travel in the upper necessitates a lower. So I'm using an upper expander here. There are markings on the bar. This is exactly 8 millimeters of expansion. So her 33 would now be 41. And when we get her to 41, 33 plus 8, the lower has to follow. The lower expander needs to follow. So the back teeth meet. We need the back teeth to come together and bite appropriately. And we can't do 8 on top with nothing on the bottom. They wouldn't match. So we give her the 8 millimeters on top and we give her the 8 on the bottom. We put some brackets on. We line up teeth as they're coming in. So this is just a little bit of expansion with a little bit of alignment. And sure enough, we're going to get those 8 millimeters. Now, the difference here is that when we were at 33, she had a list of struggles. But by the time we get to 8 millimeters, we're a few months into expansion, her symptoms are gone. And so if her symptoms are gone and she's breathing through her nose and sleeping through the night and all of a sudden starting to feel better, we start talking to Dad about, he was the one who came that appointment. So we just mentioned it that, you know, if she's feeling better and her symptoms are reducing, we should talk about the medication because there's a chance to get past that. So he goes home, he talks to Mom, but a week later they call back because she tells her parents she feels better and she doesn't think she needs the medication anymore. And that's kind of big for an almost 11-year-old to say to her parents, I think I'm feeling so much better. I don't need medicine anymore. And it turns out when you start talking to the kids, children taking medication believe they are broken. So children who take medication believe there's something wrong with them. They need to be fixed. And the medication is helping them because they are either broken or there's something wrong with them. There's a whole dynamic going on that you start to figure out as time goes by. You start talking to these kids. She wants to get off of that medicine just as badly as everybody else wants her off of it. So talking to the MD and then the prescription medication reduction starts. I don't meet many children where they can just stop taking medicine because the medicine they're taking, the amphetamine-based medication is very addictive. It does come with withdrawal symptoms. And even in smaller doses, the kids can't really stop it immediately because it would be like having withdrawal symptoms. So it's almost always the case that they have to do reduction. And reduction can be months to years, depending upon the number of medications they're taking and how many they're taking, plus the dosages. Some kids are taking multiple medicines. Some kids, the child dose didn't work. So they're not on a pediatric dose. They're actually on an adult dose of a medication. And so those kids will take longer. So the more medicines, the longer it will take. And the higher the dosages are, the longer it's going to take. So the medication reduction begins. We're going to remove the expanders because she's only 11. She still has a few more teeth to erupt. What I like to do is take my expanders out and give them a guidance appliance. So we'll give them a guide. Because you don't want retainers when you're only 11. You're not supposed to retain anybody at 11. They need to keep growing. So we give them a guide so that they can still have nasal breathing and tongue and cheek and lip, all the function going on that we'd like to have. We'd like her to still keep getting bigger and bigger over time. But the difference here is 33 to 41. Now, 33 is between 3 and 14. And then, of course, on this side, 3 and 14 is now 41. So all of a sudden, you have this nice change with the foundation and the lower opens up beautifully too to follow along. And now she has a beautiful foundation with, you know, really well-aligned teeth and needs a very tiny bit, but we're going to use a guide because she's only 11. Let's let all the teeth erupt. And gradually she's going to get, you know, a little bit older. We'll take a look. So here you can see a decrease in the amount of inflammation. It's not perfect, but it is an improvement. And in this time frame, it's not like the 10 or 11-year-old is brushing their teeth any better. So they're still doing their same habits. You know, whatever you brush your teeth, great. You try to do it twice a day. We give them the usual instructions, but this is not that she's all of a sudden, you know, brushing, flossing, water picking, water flossing. And all of a sudden we have a nose breather on our hands who can sleep through the night. So the 8 millimeters, getting her above 40 works the same for most children. Once you get above 40, you start experiencing really nice changes in your health. Now, fast forward, time's going to go by and one night we'll be at college night at the high school and you know, the mom is running down the hall yelling my name. And when you're in a crowd, it turns out we go in the same school district. So you hear your name at college night, you're trying to duck into a closet and hide because the last thing you need in college night is, oh, you know, Dr. Ben, I'm so glad you're here. Can you take my teeth? Because I think I chipped this or that. You want to look at my mouth? I don't want to do that at college night. I was trying to hide, but she caught up to me and she just wanted to say thank you. She caught up to say thank you, thank you, thank you, because that happened to be the same week that Molly was now off all of the meds, out of small group and back to full class, and now saying how easy math is for herself. And, you know, one of the issues that she had when we talk about small group, it just so happens that's what the school referred to it was. In the morning, you have like a homeroom meeting, everybody's in the same room, but then the announcement finishes with all kids who are in small group, now you can go to your class, and two kids or three kids out of every class get up and leave. And I call that a walk of shame. You know, I call that a walk of shame because you're being called out to your small group. You have to get up and walk in front of the whole class and leave. I can imagine that does not feel that good. And meanwhile, I don't know if everybody's paying attention to this, but that's got to feel really terrible to have to get up and leave. So she gets back into full class. She's no longer called out to leave her classes. And then you can go, you know, a little further. You get an email one day that says, hey, I wanted to send you a note regarding Molly. We had a meeting on Friday with the educational team regarding Molly's progress in school. She's made huge strides, now has an A average. She's fully integrated into regular math and science classes. I keep thinking about our conversation years ago. You described your teaching topics and in particular, the focus on the size of the airway and how important it was for sleep. You told us a story of another girl just like Molly and showed us before and after pictures. The procedure changed this girl's academic career. all weekend I had flashbacks to that conversation. I wanted to say thanks for the guidance on expanders for Molly. It's been life-changing for her. So now we've got this child who's growing up healthy with no medication, and one day she'll be 16. And here she is at 16. And at this point, she's not really doing anything. You know, by 12, 13 years old, the guide runs out of gas. You stop wearing it. So from 12 or 13 up to 16, this is now 3 years with nothing. And she's just basically in a position where her teeth are close to where they belong. She has beautiful width. She still maintains the 41. So beautiful width of the upper arch, a tiny bit of space there. Beautiful anterior, you know, bite. Everything's nicely, you know, positioned. She's obviously had a little better gingival, you know, situation going on from the before where she had her inflammation and gingivitis. And then the lower arch has this little bit of crowding here. And so we talked about that at a previous visit. We're just going to make her a few aligners. And so this is a kid who's been 3 years stable, but since the age of 11 years old to 16 is 5 years. We're 5 years medication free, 5 years straight A student, basically 5 years healthy. And now we've got this tiny bit of tooth to attend to. So we're going to make her a few aligners to finish the job. Her smile is terrific. And, you know, it's a nice example of what a smile could look like at 33 millimeters. It doesn't look that bad. You know, on the left side of the screen, if you're just looking at the picture, you would say, well, it's not a bad bite. She doesn't have any crowding, but you take a full history and you learn that's an unhealthy child. So you don't need a set of severe crowded teeth to say, oh, I have to jump in and help that child. You just need to make a good diagnosis, and a transverse measurement is your way to go. Without crowding, we were able to give her 8 millimeters, and she still has all her teeth lined up beautifully without significant gaps everywhere. You need a big foundation early so you can breathe and sleep well. Then you need to coordinate the teeth later. And it turns out expanders to guides gives you a chance to do very little to her teeth after. So now we'll make her a few aligners to do a little fine tuning. But now you, at least at 16, you've got a 5-year run at healthy, non-medicated child that could really have all the potential in the world being an A student. Whereas the C student who is struggling, you're limited in your potential. We all know where that's going. You know, high school sets up college, sets up your career, and the better you can do along the way, the more opportunities you have. So why shouldn't the child have every opportunity? TMD, the TMD patients pop in. Of course, you can't be in a dental practice without hearing about jaw pain and facial pain and headaches and all the stuff that is TMD related, but this one has a slightly different course. So this patient ends up in our office and brings some photos with her and then tells her story that I have a picture from 2011. This is my smile. But it turns out in 2016, she went and had clear aligners. So somewhere else, not in our practice, she had clear aligners somewhere from 2016 to 17. During that time, she started to complain about her TMD, her jaw developing pain, jaw and facial pain during the treatment. And then at the end, it stayed. But in 2017, when she was done, her pictures, she feels her smile is more narrow than it used to be. And so hard to disagree that her smile is probably a little more narrow. So you ask questions and you say, well, you wore aligners for a year. Did anybody polish between your teeth? And it would have felt like either a strip being put, like abrasive flossing, or maybe a disc or a type of drill. And she said, yep, I had the polishing between my teeth, a lot of it in my front teeth. So we know what that is. It's IPR, interproximal reduction. So now we've got someone who had on the left side of the screen in 2011, what looks to be minor crowding, but ended up having an aligner session for a year with IPR. And that is most likely retractive technique. So with IPR comes some retraction. The posterior was not widened at all, and her crowding was cut and eliminated by aligning her front teeth. But with that retraction technique, it trapped her lower jaw a little bit further. And all she needed was a little bit of retraction to drive that lower jaw back a fraction and change her condyle, disc, and musculature enough to be uncomfortable. So now she's in our office, and we'll take records and see that, yeah, her front teeth are straight and her bite looks okay, except for the fact that we've got a long list of TMD symptoms that are bothering her. And she's already been through the IPR and the aligners, but we make a measurement. And again, the transverse measurement, the distance between 3 and 14, she measures 30. Now, 30 millimeters, if you've heard me speak before, you probably are aware when that number is appropriate. It's age 4. So going back to Dr. Bogue's research, when you look through Bogue, McNamara, and anthropology research, you can kind of track what normal, good, ideal jaw growth and development is, and a 4-year-old should be 30. So A to J in a 4-year-old, if you have 30, you're at the low end of being okay to fit your teeth in. So 30 millimeters is unacceptable for a 4-year-old. It's certainly not good for an adult where we'd like to be 40 and above. And sure enough, we're in here at 30 with a trapped lower jaw, straight teeth. Again, we have straight teeth and a the teeth do connect, but we don't call this a good bite. This is not a good bite because you have TMD symptoms. So we're going to talk about removable expanders for her because she needs a significant amount of growth first before I can play with the teeth. And when you're 30 millimeters and you've got TMD symptoms, I love simple removable Schwartz appliances. So we do this with a really slow technique over a long period of time, but it's a non-surgical approach. And not many patients are looking for jaw surgery. So we try to talk about the options, and non-surgery, non-surgical approaches are agreeable and conservative. We will use an upper and lower removable Schwartz appliance worn in cycles day and night with a beautiful pattern to get the maxilla and the mandible to grow a little bigger for her. The distance you're looking at here is about 6 millimeters that's achieved. So when this started out, these, the pink resin or acrylic was together. You know, this was an appliance that was together at the beginning and then it separated. Same thing on the lower. This was, these two halves were together at the beginning. And now over time, and this is probably a good 12 to 15 months of time to get that 6 millimeters of change, we'll switch her into aligners then. So she will go from the removable expanders to the aligners. And when we're done with her, we'll have gone from 30 to 40 millimeters. So we'll have taken someone who has absolutely no crowding, a 10 millimeter increase in the width. So between 3 and 14 goes from 30 to 40 and only open up maybe 3 millimeters total of space, two on one side, one on the other. So just because you expanded or grew her 10 millimeters doesn't mean you get 10 millimeters of space. So now you're basically going through the expansion appliances first, the aligners second, and every bit of the movement is wider and forward. If I can use the removable expanders for the first 6, maybe 7 millimeters, I can get the other 3 or 4 out of the aligners. So the expander, the removable expanders don't give me the whole 10. I usually get about 2/3 with that. So then you get a 6, 7 millimeters there. Maybe then you get 3, 4 with the aligners. But when the aligners go in, you're still doing back teeth wider, front teeth forward. We talk at the beginning about space. You're going to get a little bit of space, but that space probably equals the IPR she had, because when you're cutting between all the teeth, now I have to make up for tooth loss on top of it. So overall, we go from 30 to 40, but the good news is her symptoms go away. So from the moment we start using the removable expanders and start to grow, all of a sudden, and you can see here, we put the space behind the premolar. She's got about a millimeter behind each premolar on that side there. So all of a sudden you have this wide open arch. The tongue has more room. The growth of the upper really delivers the freedom for the lower jaw. And we have two different people here. On the left side of the screen is a 30 millimeter kind of a bite. On the right side is a 40 millimeter bite. And the person on the right side of the screen has no symptoms. So no more TMD, no more facial pain, no more tension, no more clicking, no more tightness. None of the description that she had, which she received from a retractive technique, is now present. And all we had to do is reverse what was done. She did not have a history in TMD before this. So when you're in 2016 and you're doing a retractive technique and the symptoms come on, you can talk to your patients. You might learn that they didn't have the symptoms before. So she does not have a history of TMD symptoms. This is a direct result of retractive technique. We go the opposite direction to bring her back to where, you know, she should be. And this opens up a lot of room. Next thing you know, you have a different smile. So from 2011, where she kind of started, 2017 was post a retractive IPR technique. Maybe it's narrower a little bit, but she was not happy, of course, with the TMD resulting from that. And sure enough, after we've done 10 millimeters of growth and development, most of it by removable expansion appliances, we can take her to here. This happens to be a 40-year-old. So this is a 40-year-old patient going through this. And sure enough, we treated her. She's 5 years now. So she's 5 years post treatment and hasn't had a single TMD symptom. She only wears a clear removable retainer every night. And that's what she wears to bed to keep her, you know, teeth aligned nicely. The TMD continues because we do meet people who have TMD at all different ages. So TMD, this one is a little more. We've got snoring, teeth grinding. When we talk to mom, it turns out mom is a myofunctional therapist. So since mom is myofunctional therapist, we're going to basically take her into treatment and mom will do the therapy for us. So it's great. Mom can do the myofunctional therapy, but the teeth, the TMD, the snoring, the teeth grinding since she's very young. So as far as mom can remember, she's been grinding her teeth her whole life, but the snoring really bothers her. They did not get a sleep test. So without a sleep test, we can only say you're snoring by parent report. We don't have a sleep study to say you are any type of an OSA type of patient. So you're snoring with TMD symptoms. And sure enough, we'll take our records. There's a little bit of crowding here. So again, we look at some of these bites and they're not horrific, but they are underdeveloped. And so we have opportunities for these patients. When we take a look in our measurement, again, 32, go for that transverse measurement. It's a nice indicator where you are. At 32 millimeters with having TMD symptoms, young enough, this patient was 20 something. So in a 20 something category at 32 millimeters, I really like the removable expanders first. The lower has a little bit of crowding. So since the lower has a little crowding, I could probably do aligners there. She does have a class one bite on both sides for those who pay attention to that or want to see what that might look like. The tongue, a little bit of a frenum tightness. So I would look at this and do the Marcazon protocol, you know, between Dr. Zaghi, Dr. Marcazon, Dr. Kotlow, you have these protocols out there. Learn them, take a look at this. You can always then say to the myofunctional therapist, do you think we have tightness in any of these frenum? Looking for, you know, backup on this. I think this one might be, that one might be. Mom is the OMT. So we say to mom, do you believe? Oh yeah, I think it's tight. It has to be. So of course the revision will get done at some point. I like to make some room first, get some good therapy under our belt. Here's a removable in the upper. This is again, a good 6-7 millimeters of growth for that patient over time. This is again, 12 to 15 months, nice and slow. So we're going to get the first 6-7 millimeters out of an upper removable expander, but we threw lower aligners in there. So the lower aligners can start to upright and unravel so they can follow along. And this nice age here, the lower aligners can give you really nice dentoalveolar movement. So by the time we're done with her, we can get her to 40. Now she came in and didn't really have a lot of crowding and her laterals were undersized. And we talked a lot about the spacing, but in this particular case, they didn't want to have any bonding or adding to the teeth, which is fine. And then, of course, if we're trying to hide it for aesthetics, I'll shift it behind the premolar. So had the parent let me do some bonding, I would have put it on the laterals, but we didn't want that here. So we just gave the shift to the premolar site. Here, it's 2 millimeters plus. So it's a hygienic space that can be maintained very easily. Things don't get wedged in there. And of course, the difference is 32 to 40. So we have an 8 millimeter, you know, bigger jaw here, and the palate has changed, the vault has changed, like all of this stuff is different. Now that child is breathing through the nose, sleeping through the night, not grinding their teeth, and now they have no symptoms. So the TMD symptoms are all gone. The wider and forward dynamic of the upper frees the lower. So while this got that much bigger, 8 millimeters, the lower is going to have to follow it, and you can see the difference in the back. And so certainly, you know, the good news is that with all of that nice room and expansion, she can keep those wisdom teeth, which we're not a big fan of taking those out anymore. We like to grow the foundation the right size and keep them. But you can see the difference from lingual inclination. You know, the posterior teeth are leaning in versus the posterior teeth are upright. And that gives your tongue a whole lot more space. So very nice to be able to offer a significant amount of expansion. This happens to be 8 millimeters, but again, getting to that minimum number of 40 millimeters across. So your tongue has room. You can breathe through your nose. You can have few or no TMD symptoms and basically have someone who's really healthy. You can maintain as near a class one as possible. We know we have space between the premolars on each side. So you maybe don't have a perfect class one, but what you do have is a healthy patient. And so as the years have gone by, I have been less concerned with how the back teeth connect, as that was just a classification system. That was not any type of a connection for healthy or unhealthy, that was just a classification. This is what it means to be class one. They connect like this, or class two or three. So I really rely more on the transverse measurement because that has more to do with the nasal chamber and the tongue space. And it turns out with 2 decades of doing this, I believe I have proved to myself that it's the transverse measurement is probably the most important one that we could take for any child or human and figure out where to go from there. I think you'll have more benefit out of treating the transverse dimension than the sagittal or the vertical. So when you get to this point, you have the before picture, which didn't look horrific, but it came with a child who is snoring, clenching and grinding their teeth and has TMD symptoms. And on the right side of the screen, of course, removable expander on the upper and lower aligners. Then when the removable expander is done with its growth, you go into upper aligners to finish the job. Then you have a fantastic bite, beautiful teeth, a little whitening gel in the aligners, of course, lightens the shade. But, and I know we like to stare at the teeth, but you should look at the foundation and see how beautiful that maxilla looks. Because that maxilla, it's 8 millimeters bigger from 32 to 40. And 6 or 7 of those millimeters came from a removable expander to grow that bone. So this is not teeth moving through the bone. This is not tooth movement or tipping. This is basically a significant amount of jaw growth first. That's the removable expander, followed by dentoalveolar growth with the aligners giving us our tooth positions. One of the big differences in the back teeth is the lingual inclination is now gone. You know, when you have excess lingual inclination, you have horizontally loaded posterior teeth. You may as well upright all the teeth and have full vertical load. Upright posterior teeth, full vertical load, that's much healthier. We're supposed to have vertical load so the forces can go through the crown, through the roots, and into the bone. This is a really healthy human being now. So what was a smile that is kind of okay at picture, you know, wise, but then you take your history and you learn, well, that's an unhealthy child. Now is a beautiful smile that is broad and wide, but comes with a child that has no symptoms and does not snore, does not grind her teeth, basically sleeps beautifully, is asymptomatic. And again, this one is probably a good 3 to 4 years post-treatment. She just wears a clear retainer every night. And the clear retainers every night are fantastic. They're protective if you like them to be. But if you have developed the right amount of space and you have a good breather on your hands, they won't be doing much grinding. You should know it in your retainers as the years are going by. So you should be, it's a really good test to see how much room did you give that patient and how well they're breathing. Because if you did enough for the tongue space and you got the myofunctional therapy to train the tongue to live in this new home it has, if you have all that under control, you should recognize that the retainers that they wear to bed every single night don't change 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, 2 years later, it should look the same. It shouldn't look worn through like they're grinding on it. So that's a nice sign that you did enough. You went far enough. Some people come in with obstructive sleep apnea as a diagnosis. I don't treat OSA. I have never treated OSA. I do not tell patients I treat OSA. I do not teach that I treat OSA. I treat malocclusion. I treat underdeveloped jaws. And so some people come in and happen to have a diagnosis, and we still measure and talk to them about their jaws, their teeth, and what we can do to make more tongue space, but not treat OSA. And it just so happens, you know, improvements can happen. So we meet a gentleman like this. Now we're talking about someone in their 60s. And so if you're 60 years old and you have, you know, crowded teeth and all the signs of, you know, occlusal trauma, you've got recession, you've got abfraction, you got the clenching and grinding going on. Certainly you have a little bit of crowding. We are narrow with crowding. And so we're going to be looking for the same pathway expansion. So we'll take that patient in, but we do get information from a sleep study. They have numbers on the sleep study and, you know, hypopnea index 24, RDI, AHI plus REI 34. So it does come with a moderate sleep apnea diagnosis. So he comes in with a moderate sleep apnea diagnosis and he has a CPAP, he monitors everything. He's very good with his nutrition as well as exercise. So physically fit, does daily exercise and it watches his nutrition. He has very good control over those things, but still has these numbers. So this dates back a while ago. I dug this one out of the archives. This goes back to when I believed you needed attachments. You can see that. I put them right there for you to see. I had put 4 in here. So we did this with 4 attachments way back when. So this has to date back more than 5 years ago because I haven't used an attachment in 5 years. And so this is, probably a good 7 years ago. But we did open them up. You know, you can see here at the top, it doesn't have a lot of crowding, but we can make them a lot wider. And you can tell there's a difference between the canine width. So the canines are expanded, the premolars are expanded more. So widening the arch to give more room. And this again is a clear aligner only case. No expanders first, no removable expanders. We went right at this with clear aligners, expanded the arch here, and then the lower can follow along. So all of a sudden we've got the lower following the upper. So it's a significant amount of change. And in that significant amount of change, we have an opportunity to see a difference. So certainly everything is wider and more upright instead of the canine angled in that excess lingual inclination. That canine is upright now. That will free up the lower jaw. And as everything unravels here, we end up with an overall AHI down to 7. So after we are done with him, he goes right back into repeat a sleep study and he comes out with a 7. So he ended up going from 34 to 7, which is very nice. Now I know 7 is still mild because the numbers begin at 5, I believe. 0 to 5 is under 5 is okay, but 5 to 15 might be the mild category. So he's a 7. So he's still in the OSA category. I wasn't treating his OSA. I was basically all I did with aligners was give him tongue space. So, but 34 to 7 is significant because you go from moderate to mild and it makes it a lot easier. So this is a gentleman who's, you know, well-researched and well-versed on his OSA. He is not overweight. He does not have that issue. He is a bicyclist. So he bicycles a lot. So he knew he had maintained the same level of exercise and nutrition throughout the treatment. So he knew that tracking his exercise and nutrition being the same all the way through the treatment, I didn't have to say anything at the end. He knew after that sleep study, the only difference that we did was the aligners. The only difference we had here was the aligners giving me tongue space. I've done nothing different all year long. So you can attribute the change to the aligners only in my case. And I said, well, thank you. I will teach and share that with everybody because I wasn't treating your OSA, but giving you back tongue space makes the difference. And thanks to you controlling your diet and your nutrition and your exercise routine to be the same all along and his weight's the same within a pound or two over the whole course of a year. He, very structured, this gentleman, he knew for sure that, oh, wow, this gave me enough tongue space to change my number like that. And it's not a cure, but it's a difference and it's an improvement. Then it brings us to this one here, who I would characterize as a victim. This is a victim. You'll see what I mean when we get into the pictures. You know, this is a patient who is referred to me, not for aligners, not for orthopedics or orthodontics, but really for a full implant reconstruction. And so this dates back a ways. I'll tell you the dates in a little bit, but at the age that she comes, she's 46 years old. And at age 46, she comes into the office, and the very first visit, when I walked in the room to introduce myself and say hello, she introduced herself. And the first words out of her mouth, I'll never forget it, because no one has ever said this to me in the 21 years I'm doing this or 31 years in the practice. She said to me, "Before I let you look in my mouth, I'm going to tell you what happened to it." And I said, "Yes." And I just listened. And she said, "When I was a teenager, they took out my teeth to do the braces. And the moment they took out those teeth and started squeezing it all together, everything in my mouth went south. And it has been a disaster since." So she's 46 when she comes in. And this is, you know, basically braces from 12 to like 16-ish. So we'll say it's 30 years of me trying to manage this with a periodontist. I have been in periodontal care for the last 30 years because the damage was so much from that treatment that I've had to maintain. And here I am in your office, and we have to talk about replacing all my teeth, and I'm 46. So I'm angry. I'm not happy about any of this, but my periodontist that I've been going to, and she was going to the same periodontist for over 2 decades. And I happen to know the person. I have done the types of restorative work with them. They know me. They said, "You really need to go to Dr. Miraglia because you're going to need a full implant reconstruction for your mouth. Maybe 6 or 8 upper implants, 6 or 8 lower implants. Let's give you back, you know, all of it." And she said, "And I'm ready for that because I know what I look like. I know what happened to me. I know it's not going to last much longer. Let's get it done. I'm here for implants." And sure enough, the periodontist who sent her in said, "Ben, you're going to work up this case for implant reconstruction. We're going to get her, you know, through this process and get her into a fixed. She doesn't want removable." Well, here's the picture. So we took some pictures. And basically, we took enough photos and measurements to then have her back. And we sat down for a consultation. But let me just tell you what's here. Actually, you could see what's here. I referenced this patient as a victim of this. And she knew full well what happened to her when she was a teenager. Well, they took out the 4 byes. And they must have used an incredible amount of force. And she on and on and on and on kept reminding me that this is not her fault. She is not a bad brusher. And so when you get to know someone over a period of time, you recognize, oh yeah, she has done everything right except for what happened to her. So good oral hygiene her entire life and good nutrition too. So check those 2 boxes off. And meanwhile, this is where she landed. Now the troubles began right at 16 years old. She knows the moment the braces came off, you could see the damage already. And the x-rays showed it, and the photographs showed it, and the problems that she had. And here we are with composite bonded between the incisors there. And we'll take a look in here. We can see she's got a couple of, like a little splint over here. You see the wire, like 3 teeth are bonded together. There's a wire through number 3. And then of course, 4 to 6, there's a little wire here because the tooth was so loose and they stuck a wire to hold that so it wouldn't fall out. And then of course the lower has composite wedged between the teeth, locking those together. So we've got, you know, kind of like a little lingual splint going on with the composite. And she's had her fillings and a crown here and there. But meanwhile, this is a lot of damage. And here's how much damage. When you see from the side, you can look at, she has frication involvements already. She does go to her periodontist for the last 2 decades. She's been going to the same one for 2 decades, which is a couple towns over. And sure enough, for 2 decades, there's every 3 months. She's in there every 3 months. She's meticulous at home because she knows she couldn't afford for basically the last 30 years. She knew she couldn't afford any change for any reason. So she has had a healthy diet and incredible oral hygiene since. She never has a fleck of anything on there. So tight tissue, pink tissue, stable, but there's no bone here. And so there's a lot of bone loss and a lot of mobility and all kinds of trouble on both sides. And sure enough, you know, you get a composite here and there in that fraction, and you got a crown. So you got 3 crowns on this side and fillings in the other teeth and the composite on the lower anterior. But it does come with an x-ray, and you know, it's a little grainy, but I think you can see what's happening there. You know, the composite is wedged in between the incisors, and she has a little bit of bone left in the incisors, right? and then the furcation involvements in the molars, and that's quite a bit going on. So we did have a full consultation, and we sat down at the consultation, and obviously you're going to see this patient go through aligners. But I talked to her in the consultation. I said, you know, I can understand why you were sent to me, and that we can certainly replace all of this with beautiful implants. I can show you those cases over and over and over. And but I understand you're, you know, 46 years old, and I'm interested in trying something. And I said, if we're going to replace all these teeth for implants anyway one day, what is the harm in aligning them better to give you a better bite? Because your bite is terrible. And I understand what happened. You didn't do any of this, but your bite is so bad that it's causing you a lot of trauma. And I believe it's a significant part of your problem. Even if we just take these out and put implants in, the way the gum and the bone are all shaped and positioned, we don't have anything lined up nicely. What if we move your teeth a little bit first? Can you give me a chance to move your teeth? So basically, I made her an offer she couldn't refuse, which was, we're going to lose these teeth anyway. Let me do a round of clear aligners on you. Because if we do 12 months of aligners and you still need all implants everywhere for this entire thing, I will credit the amount you spend on the aligners into that case, because we already know what that's going to cost. You're going to be spending a crazy number to put in 6 or 8 implants in each arch. That's a big number. I'll just credit you the aligner case. Meanwhile, what if it does make an improvement and you can get a little longer out of this because you're only 46. And what if you could go to 48 or 50 or any other year other than 46 to replace all your teeth? We talked it through and she agreed. So we put her in aligners. So I put her in aligners and I moved her teeth. I moved the upper, I spread them out a little bit. I spread out the lower teeth a little bit. At the end, of course, to do it, I had to take out the bonding that was in between those teeth. But at the end, I put in a lower lingual bar with a nice layer of bonding over there to be a permanent fixed retainer. And you're looking at that permanent fixed retainer. By the time I got done with the expansion and the shaping of her arch, I had this particular bite here, which was more balanced. She had contact everywhere. She wasn't traumatizing anybody anywhere. And it didn't really change a whole lot from the amount of recession and or bone loss she had. In fact, when I show you the x-ray next, we actually grew several millimeters of bone around her lower incisors. So all of a sudden, I had her lower incisors embedded in several millimeters of bone from where they had almost none. So to take her to here, now the big surprise ending is when I did this, she is now 12 years post-treatment. She's 58 now. So we did this 12 years ago. And 12 years ago when we did this for her, she's had 12 years going to the periodontist every 3 months. 12 years, she hasn't lost a single tooth. She hasn't had a root canal, a crown, a filling, a cavity. She's had no dentistry in 12 years. And all she does is now wear her clear retainer to bed every night. So we were able to move her teeth, improve her bite, grow her bone back, and give her 12 years. She's now 58. So every time she goes to the periodontist, I get a letter. Then, and it started out early on, the first letter I got was, you are crazy. Absolutely not. We're making implants. And then I had to teach him that, wait, if we're taking it all out anyway, what's the difference if we start moving it? There's no negative to trying this for her. He agreed. We moved on. He was calling me nuts for 2 years because he said, oh, it's going to all fall apart. It's all going to fall apart. Well, then the letter started to change to, I can't believe it's still there. I can't believe it's still there. Now it's, you really saved that woman and you have 12 years on. I can't believe it's still there. She goes to the same periodontist every 3 months. She comes to see me now every 6 months. She pops in every 6 months. I take a look in there. I say, you don't need me anymore. You're in great shape. And now you're 58. And she's very happy. Now that all this has transpired, I can tell you, I believe, I've been looking at her for 12 years plus the treatment time. So I know her 14 years pretty much. Over the time frame and just peeking at her along the way, I don't think she's ever going to lose these teeth. I think she can keep them for the distance. I'm starting to believe it. But even then, it doesn't matter now. She got 12 years at this point, but nothing has changed. Not a root canal, not a filling, not a crown, zero going on in that mouth. All thanks to creating a better bite and shaping those teeth. So I'm here to tell you that, yeah, clear aligners are pretty powerful. You weren't going to do this with braces, I can tell you that. That's not happening with braces. Braces would be something that would start extracting those teeth. So we're not a candidate for braces, but the clear aligners are different. And we teach that in our coursework, what we do differently. So thank you very much for enduring that on a Wednesday night for over an hour of me babbling about teeth and patients and stuff. But I hope you saw something that was new and exciting tonight. And I hope that you might look at your patients a little bit differently going forward. And I'm sure there's a question or two. Usually I try five.
That is wonderful. You know, you showed 8 cases today. I'm trying to think about the thousands of people you've treated. I mean, if we could just go and go through all of these stories and really the difference you've made and then taught others how to do the same, we really, really appreciate all the work you do and sharing it with others. And something that resonates with me personally is that when you're talking about the broken children, how they feel broken, you know, I've heard you say that before, but it's been a while, and it's just such a gift that we can really turn that around through proper growth and development. And you will enjoy your profession so much more. You'll get hooked just like you did, Ben, right? Where it's like all you need is one child to turn around, and then that child isn't broken anymore, and it gets addicting. So yes, we have plenty of questions here. I'm going to start with some of the ones right in the chat here. When do you decide to use a palatal expander and not just the guides?
Sure. So I am a big fan of using the guides from 3 to 7 years old. And so in my own office for the last 2+ decades, 3 to 7 years old, the guides are wonderful. And of course, you're including, again, myofunctional therapy, necessary frenum releases, lots of nasal hygiene instruction and recommendations for the kind of natural sprays to use. So when I say guides, sometimes I kind of skim over the rest of it, but it is like 3 things. It's guide, myofunctional therapy, and then with any necessary revisions that are needed with nasal hygiene. So that's kind of the trifecta of things going on with the kids. 3 to 7, the guides are so effective with the myofunctional therapy and their frenum releases that you shouldn't get into expanders then. You should totally avoid expanders. And the kids who are very compliant can avoid a set of braces or aligners. So we have about a 25% rate. Kids who are 3 to 7 who get their guides early, do it right, all of a sudden they'll turn 12, and 25% of them don't need braces or aligners. They're done. The 75% of those kids are going to need some clear aligners for a few months. And if the clear aligners can be worn, you can do that. If not, you can put on braces for a few months because you've already got the breathing musculature and the foundation right. If you have the right size foundation and you have the breathing and the musculature and you have no symptoms, then it's okay to have a bracket and wire technique as long as it's expansive. And we teach that too, so that you can have an expansive technique to solve that child's tooth issue when they're 12 or 13. Then of course there's 8 to 12. So it's from 8 to 12 where I use expanders, and that percentage also runs about 1 in 4 kids. So 3 out of 4 kids between 8 and 12 can use the guides very nicely. And guides, myofunctional therapy, nasal hygiene, frenum releases, that little package can do a lot from 8 to 12. But the kids who come in with bilateral crossbite, that's a tough one to get out of. Unilateral, surprisingly, the guides in the myofunctional therapy will do very well there. So bilateral crossbite, and then the measurements, if they're close to 30 or under 30, I have trouble with the guides getting them all the way to 40, and I want them to be at 40. So I usually think about the numbers. What are their measurements like? So if you're near 30 or under 30, you're going to be in a fixed expanders first, then go into guides second. If we do fixed expanders, you're going to meet the myofunctional therapist right after they come out, because during the expansion with the expanders in both jaws, it's not that fun to do the myo then. So I like to get the foundation really big, send them off to myo with their guide in place, and they can work with that. So yeah, 8 to 12, my own office runs about 25% of the kids are going to get fixed expanders. 75% of those kids are going to get guides, and they do very well. The goal is, again, breathing, musculature, foundational growth early. We take care of all of that early so that they're symptom-free, medication-free. Then we look at the 12, 13-year-old and say, what do your teeth need? And a quarter of them need nothing, and the other 3/4 get 6 months, maybe 8 months in aligners most of the time, because I like aligners more. And sometimes I'll do braces for the kids who can't wear the aligners well, and they do need their teeth to have some final alignment for perfection. The parents want them perfectly straight. So I basically had to go and learn how to do the braces expansively, because why would I send them anywhere else after I've already helped a child like this? If I send it somewhere else, they'll just ruin the kid and go the other direction. So I'm not looking for that. So I tend to keep them all to myself now.
There are a lot of questions about guides and exactly what are guides. I have some people saying they've never heard of a guide before. What is a guide? What does it look like? Do you think it's a good idea if I share my screen just to show what a Vivos guide look like, to kind of
You could show them about a picture of one. Yeah. I have used them all. You know, I wasn't trying to really be promotional towards one or the other. I think we're on the same page there, but at least you could see what one looks like. At a glance, it looks like a sports guard. It looks like something you'd put in your mouth and play football in. But meanwhile, the design of these appliances really does help your breathing through the nose, because when you wear it, you're kind of forced, you're retraining that nasal breathing. But when your guide's in place, your tongue has to swallow by touching the roof of your mouth. So your tongue is kind of guided to the palate. So it'll either rest up there because that guide in place delivers a higher tongue position, but it also, it does make you swallow correctly because you do have to go up and down with your tongue up to the vault and kind of back. So you get more of that compression vacuum swallow going again. So it helps with the breathing and musculature. It does help also push the lips and cheeks back. So you push off on the lips and cheeks, that flange that's between the lips and cheeks, it takes the lips and cheeks out of the swallow because we're not supposed to be swallowing with our face. We're supposed to be swallowing with the tongue. So the guide basically starts pushing you in the right direction. Meanwhile, you combine the guide with a myofunctional therapist and some frenum releases, good nasal hygiene along the way, and you can really change a child's course of growth and development. So currently I do use the Vivos guides. I also use the MyoBrace guides. Those are the two that I predominantly use. 20 years ago, I tried other ones. You know, there were other companies around. I tried them all. I do use predominantly Vivos and MyoBrace today. I do teach for both companies. That's kind of the short story on that.
And then there are a lot of questions covered in the guide category here on tooth pillow. And can you just explain what is tooth pillow? There's a lot of, one of the doctors saying that parents are coming, asking them about tooth pillow, which I'm actually excited about because it's bringing it to the attention, similar to what the clear aligner companies did back in the day.
So it turns out that while these guidance appliances are very effective to use between 3 and 12 years old, not every dentist or pediatric dentist or orthodontist wants to use them. And that's okay. You know, we do have freedom of choice to do as we want to practice. But I have used those for so long and over 2 decades realized these are really beneficial. So if you go back about 10 years ago, I started teaching it, maybe more, because I think I taught the first courses in 2011, 12. I started to teach that these were out. So here I am teaching other places because if the doctor wanted to learn how to do this and use it in their own community, great, more kids benefit. So I started teaching kind of early treatment with guides and expanders way back when. But then fast forward another like 8 years later, and that was a slow pickup, meaning, okay, a few doctors are picking it up here and there. Meanwhile, they're generally unknown. Most parents don't even know what it is, even though I'm using it for 2 decades and they've been around much longer. When I start talking about this and show a parent, they're like, is this brand new? I've never heard of this. They're like, no, not new. Dates back a long way, but meanwhile, not a lot of people use them. So here we have this opportunity. Let's talk it through. Well, fast forward to a few years ago, probably about 3 now, and a few people like myself who have seen this in action and know the benefit, put our heads together and we're considered founders of Tooth Pillow, but we decided to try to solve 2 things. Number one was accessibility because very few providers are using these guides anywhere. So what if we could build a pattern of delivering this treatment remotely? Could we combine a guide, myofunctional therapy via Zoom, of course, remotely in an app, and then, of course, doing nasal hygiene products, techniques, things that you can do to support nasal hygiene, putting the 3 together. And I'm thinking to myself, well, I've been doing it in my office, just seeing the kid every 6 months. And it's just a glance like, here, how are you doing? Oh, good. Here's your new guide. So yeah, the answer is you could do this remotely. So Tooth Pillow was born to solve for accessibility, meaning any parent anywhere could research this, look it up, see what's going on, and learn about it enough to know that, oh, I think this is a good idea for my child, and order it. So what we did over the last 2 years was build out a team of about 35 people who are support that run the company for us and deal with everything on a daily basis. We also built out 70 doctors, so I have all 50 states covered. So we now have 70 doctors covering all 50 states. And we basically began with beta testing to see if we could put 50 kids into treatment nationwide and start to track them over time. And basically what we did, we solved accessibility and affordability. So it costs a little less to do this remotely than it does in an office. It's a fraction of the cost. Not many dentists want to do this or, you know, to pick this up in their practice. So what if they could just send the patient to a remote possibility, which is Tooth Pillow? So the whole thing was born out of a little bit of, you know, trying to solve a problem, beta testing. My partners in crime are Chad Rasmussen, Michelle Grasmick, Dr. Callie Hale, Dr. Kevin Goles, and you, of course, Lauren, you're one of the partners in crime. But the group of us kind of got together and we have now in the last 2.5 years gotten rolling. And I think we have almost 4,500 kids in treatment now, and it's been kind of ramping up nicely once we built out a website, once we built out a platform that is the app to connect. So we're not a direct-to-consumer. That would be mislabeling us. We don't mail something to a patient. We are treating them with a treating doctor in their state, and they have access to that treating provider through the app. So we have a support team that manages the child daily, weekly, monthly. We have treatment providers that oversee all the treatment, and the photos are brought in weekly, then monthly, then quarterly. And we review them along with the sleep breathing questionnaires so that we can pay attention to the symptoms. Certainly the children have access to full myofunctional therapy through our app, and we do one-on-one individual myofunctional therapy with these kids. And last but not least, yes, if we determine that there is a frenum issue, we can refer them to an office. So we look to get them in an office when we think. Again, we can't diagnose a frenum through the app, but the idea is when you're working with a myofunctional therapist, you start to gain, you know, discovery that you would screening, maybe calling it, that you could maybe make a referral for frenum revisions when they're needed. So we are trying to help more kids basically have early attention. We've learned a lot over the last 3 years that there's a lot of kids who don't have access to things. And when they start to look in their area, there's nobody using guides around, or, you know, nobody really offering early treatment. So we think we've stumbled onto something that is helpful. We have been growing it nicely. I'm not surprised people are walking in your offices and asking about Tooth Pillow. Yeah. And if you, you know, if you want to learn more about it, we have more people who can share more about that with you.
Yeah. And if you want to learn more about it, you can email me at info@airwayhealthsolutions.com, or I highly recommend going to their Instagram account. There's a lot of great information there. It's very patient friendly as well. We do have Chad Rasmussen with us. He is the CEO, but I think you covered most of the clinical questions. If there's any other questions that I think would, how can I join Tooth Pillow in Alberta, Canada? You know, I'm going to just table this. We'll circle back and bring Chad on for maybe a couple of questions in a row if there's more questions about Tooth Pillow. But we could always do a separate conversation just on Tooth Pillow or a lunch and learn to learn more about that specifically, if people are interested in that specifically, because there's a bunch of other questions here too. So I know there are questions about your wear and turn instructions for the removable expanders, and that's why you created a course. So maybe you could just touch upon that a little bit. Yeah. About the techniques of what you do and how you can't just, I wish we could just answer it in the chat, because then yeah, more people could be helped, but it's not that simple. So you want to talk a little bit about why we developed the mini residency?
Yeah, we developed an adult mini residency to review the actual techniques of using removable expansion devices on adults. And so, you know, for the 2 decades I've been doing this, you know, Airway Health Solutions, we created that about 6 years ago now. So, you know, that's 14 years. That makes 14, almost 15 years of these patient cases that we've been building this educational platform from. And I can't teach it in the minutes answering a question here or even in a chat. And I wouldn't recommend anybody tomorrow saying, well, I saw him do a removable expander on an adult, I'll do that too. You should learn how to do it. Believe me, when I did the first one, I was a little uncomfortable. But then slowly but surely, you learn a lot about bone dynamics, cycling, pressure, and tension. And you can see that there is a pathway to help an adult human being grow their bone at an older age. And it does come with a very specific technique. I would encourage you to take the adult mini residency. Not only do we cover that technique in there, we also cover a lot of clear aligner education. So you could learn about expansive clear aligner technique, because that might not be the default you're getting back in your treatment plans. You might be getting a retractive technique. And if you would like to pursue an expansive technique, we basically teach a little to no IPR technique and a minimal attachment technique. So you have an opportunity to learn about using clear aligners. And that's a wonderful opportunity to learn more. And then you might be able to do that on your patients, but not tomorrow.
What measurement tool do you use specifically to measure between 3 and 14? And yes, is there a digital option for that as well?
Yeah, so the Bowley gauge. Now, you can use a Bowley gauge, and the traditional one is a slide rule. So it has the long arms, and when you put them in the mouth, you separate the arms to touch 3 and 14. When you take it out, you read the ruler. But there are digital Bowley gauges now, so you can spend a little more money, and it has a little digital thing on it. So you slide it open, and it tells you the actual number. That's a little more accurate. But then the last resort, which is very nice, is to use a cotton roll. So it turns out the cotton rolls that you have in your practice are 37 millimeters long. So if your cotton roll is 37 millimeters, you can take it and hold it, touch one of those molars and go to the other tooth, see how it looks, take it out of the mouth, trim a little off, go back. Once you have a cotton roll that fits between 3 and 14 gently, you can take it out and measure it on a ruler and see, do I have 28? Am I 32? Is it 34? So just, it's a 5-second assessment too, but it will give you a really good idea whether you've got tongue space and nasal chamber space for your patient. And most likely it'll be related, as does all of the sleep disorder breathing and OSA research represent that narrow shows up in all that research. your patients are having their breathing problems because they're narrow. And so you can help them out. Cotton roll.
Can you simply please differentiate between expansive and restrictive orthodontics?
Oh, so yeah, there are two categories. There's basically two camps for ortho. There's retractive and there's expansive. And retractive is the bracket and wire category. Braces typically are retractive. Most of the traditional brackets and wires out there today have wires that go straight back. And there are those little twin brackets that go on the teeth. You put a ligature around it so it has color and it looks sweet for the kid. But meanwhile, you're putting those in and braces don't make you wider and they don't move you forward. And that only leaves one direction, retractive. So braces will kind of force your teeth to line up going backwards. You maintain the narrow and you maintain the front position. Braces don't move you wider or forward because that throws your teeth out of the bone. Brackets and wires are fixed. It is a difference in how the bone is remodeling and you cause a lot of damage when brackets and wires try to go wider and forward. So we don't do a whole lot of expanding and proclining with braces. Now, distalization or retraction is what's happening to you with brackets and wires. It is a reverse technique. And if you have too much crowding, moderate to severe crowding means, well, there's no room for those teeth to go all the way far back. So you got to take four bicuspids out. So extraction, retraction, orthodontics is thanks to the tools. The tools are not expansive. So if you have tools that are retractive, you will do retractive techniques. Traditional bracket and wire technique is retractive. It maintains that width, which is terrible for most patients when you start measuring them. And then you talk about expansive orthodontics. Well, brackets and wires are not expansive generally, and they are really a tooth-focused approach. So we are looking more at the foundation first. Why don't you grow the foundation and then align the teeth so it's separated? But expansive orthodontics usually includes the growth and development category. Grow the jaws, then align the teeth. Expansion can come from removable expanders, fixed expanders, or clear aligners. And clear aligners might be dentoalveolar, not the sutures, but just from a little taste of an hour and 5 minutes, you've got to see what clear aligners are capable of. And you can do wonderful things with clear aligners as well. And again, mostly I try to stay in the non-surgical category, but there are surgical orthodontic techniques that are out there and we have, you know, opportunities to learn about that. Some patients benefit from surgical techniques, but this was mostly non-surgical approaches.
There's a lot of questions about nasal hygiene and nose sprays, natural nose sprays, do you recommend? But before we talk about nasal hygiene and nose sprays, why is nasal breathing so important? And is that the ultimate goal?
Yes. So that is goal number one. So whenever we're looking at a child, the goal number one is nasal breathing. We need to make that child a nasal breather because they're not. I do not meet children who can breathe through their nose for more than 30 seconds or a minute, and they are struggling to breathe through their nose because their jaws are too small. When the maxilla is too small, the lateral walls of your nasal chamber are your maxilla, so they're closer together. When your maxilla is narrow, your vault is too high. So you have a tiny, tiny nasal chamber with an underdeveloped maxilla. Of course, both jaws are small. So when they're underdeveloped, now your lower jaw is too small. When both are too small, there's no room for your tongue. So we've sacrificed or now have a compromise of the nasal chamber and the tongue space, and that makes for bad breathing. So you can't breathe through your nose, you're going to breathe through your mouth. There's a huge difference between the two. These are opposites. A human being is an obligate nasal breather. You have to breathe through your nose in order to be healthy, and there is no chance to be healthy when you are mouth breathing, whether it's day, night, or both. So the underdeveloped jaws that give you your mouth breathing, what I like to teach parents, it's the easiest way for me to teach it, is think about a high-performance car. So if we take a high-performance Ferrari, whatever it is your high-performance car that you love so much, you have to put a premium gasoline in that car for it to run beautifully. But if you take your high-performance car and you put a garbage, watered-down junk of a gasoline in that car, it will not run the same way. Well, the fuel for that car, that's the difference between nose and mouth breathing. So a human being is a Ferrari. And if you want to put the right fuel in that human being, one primary fuel that we have is oxygen, and breathing is the mechanism we get it. But breathing through your nose is fueling your body appropriately. Breathing through your mouth is fueling your body inappropriately. You're going to put bad fuel in yourself, you're going to malfunction. And so many symptoms are downstream from mouth breathing alone, which is why I like to teach parents and then other practitioners that don't worry about OSA. That's the worst you can be. You need to get back to nasal breathing because mouth breathing is unhealthy. OSA is the worst you can be. We're not going to wait for you to be OSA. We're going to start treating you earlier. Your jaws are underdeveloped. Let's treat your malocclusion. We need to convert you from mouth breathing to nose breathing. And the moment a child is nose breathing again, the symptoms fade away. So the symptoms can melt away converting a child from mouth breathing to nose breathing. And I have found over 2 decades, it requires either early treatment, guides, myofunctional therapy, frenum releases, good nasal hygiene instruction, which we'll get into in a minute, or you need some expanders in there. And in kids, it's an upper and a lower, because an upper expander only, by the ortho research out there, is an abject failure. It was basically early phase treatment. Early phase treatment with upper expanders only proved to be ineffective because of the relapse was significant enough. And the argument was that, well, if this doesn't really hold at all, why are we doing something early when we have to do it all over again at 11? So if you can't have early expansion working very well, the more important conclusion, rather than early treatment doesn't work, was what did we use during that? And maybe that was ineffective. It turns out an upper expander only was the predominance of that research. So when you use an upper expander only, you can only go a few millimeters. It's going to shrink right back. Your child's going to be in the same spot. And I've met those kids for over the last 20 years. An upper expander only usually means they have the same measurement they started with. They have no change in their symptoms. And basically, yeah, the relapse is real because we haven't helped both jaws get bigger and we haven't done any myofunctional therapy, friending releases, et cetera. So if you want a nose breather out of a child, you got to get into both expanders to get that nose breathing. And it is our primary goal is to be a nose breather. So we want full jaw size so that we can nose breathe and then we heal. Nasal hygiene, should I touch on that?
Yeah, please. That was one of the questions. And also what spray you like that's natural.
Yeah. So I'm a big fan of simple saline is totally fine. And I also like the clear products, the xylitol. And so, you know, we don't force anything on anybody. We tell the parent we use clear products, the xylitol containing, and you can certainly get some and check it yourself, read the list, do your research. And I'm a fan of that. I like the xylitol sprays clear. I also like simple saline. And what we do is we try to teach the parent that we want to blow our nose first. We got to get some junk out of there. Then we put the nasal spray in and you're basically holding one and giving a squeeze and inhaling it. You want to try to get that nasal spray to go in far enough that you kind of feel it at the back of your throat. That's a really good inhale with the spray. Do both sides. A few minutes later, it usually loosens stuff up. So then blow again and you can repeat the process. I try to avoid the steroid containing, because when we're talking about these kids who are really struggling to breathe through their nose, they need nasal hygiene multiple times a day. And so some of the kids can't breathe through their nose. We start talking about the parent. Listen, when they're at home, you got to do the nasal hygiene every hour. Every hour we blow, we spray, we blow until we get that nose up and running again. So we'll do it every hour with the goal of doing it twice a day as an outcome. Man, it could be weeks or months later. Some kids can do it three or four times a day and then get to, you know, twice a day. But the two recommendations are the clear nasal spray and the simple saline, and you're doing this blow, spray, blow multiple times a day until you can breathe through your nose. And then the nose hygiene becomes a twice a day, just like you brush your teeth. You brush your teeth in the morning and bedtime, you should clean your nose morning and bedtime at a minimum. But you have to earn that. The kids can't start out that way. They really do need to do it every hour on the hour to get rolling.
And when and if do you recommend taping of the mouth at night?
Yeah. So it turns out that I do the least amount of taping, I think. I'm not against it at all, but I can tell you just my opinion. So my opinion is the jaws are so small and there's no room for the tongue and they can't breathe well through their nose. So my opinion is I don't like to start with tape. So I don't like to start with tape because I'm just forcing something closed that doesn't have a good space to breathe through. So I prefer to have the expanders or the guides starting out, get the myofunctional therapy going, get the nose hygiene going. As you're making progress and you realize, okay, I'm breathing better, the child is breathing better, things are improving, the last resort would be, if we just need a little more support or training to keep the lips together when we're sleeping, put a piece of tape on, but not duct tape. It's not masking tape. It's not, you know, package tape. There is myotape is one of them. You know, you can get the ring. It goes around like a little ring. So, and breathable tape exists. So mouth taping, you know, it's helpful in more of, for me, it's at a final stage. Now, over time, when you're doing the growth and development and the breathing is improving, you can add a little tape to the mix. I just don't like to start with it. I'm uncomfortable starting with it.
So there's a couple of questions about the tooth pillow here, and I'm going to go ahead and bring Chad on because he's the best one to answer these. So let me promote him to panelist and he'll come back on. And meanwhile, I hope this works. I think we've done this correctly. Yeah, there we go. Chad,
hello,
everyone, welcome. Thanks for joining us tonight. I was going to keep you to the end if there were any other tooth pillow questions, but this one just caught my eye and you're here. So do you have a program within tooth pillow for myofunctional therapists to use with their patients? In my area, there are no dentists to use guides or who are really practicing airway dentistry.
Yes. We love the myofunctional therapy community. We know that that is a huge aspect of successful treatment. Guides is one thing. Dr. Ben, you talked a lot about my oral appliances and how critical or the benefits of all those, but with absence of myofunctional therapy, you're only going to get so far. We really need to retrain the dysfunction. There's so many myofunctional therapists that are doing such a good job with so many patients, but now they're lacking a dentist to help prescribe those types of oral appliances. So we really would love to just partner with them, because through this digital workflow, they can partner with another airway dentist that's in their area. So they have a patient they're already serving. They want to then have that patient receive oral appliance therapy. They can do that through our network of providers here at Tooth Pillow.
Great. Thank you. And what about doctors who are interested in learning more about becoming a Tooth Pillow provider? What would you say to them in a nutshell, if there's such a thing?
Yeah, there's 200,000 dentists in the US, and every dentist needs to be talking to their patients about this. We would really hope that those dentists get trained on how to, again, prescribe these treatments themselves in their practice and be able to oversee those patients. Not all dentists have the time or the interest to necessarily do that, and they want an expert to be able to send that to, just like how we refer patients to an endodontist or to a periodontist or whoever that is. We now need the airway odontist, if you will, the airway expert that they can refer those patients to that they know that are struggling, that have that under development. So again, at Tooth Pillow, we do have a program where a general dentist or any other type of dentist that, is concerned, but they just might not have the time or the bandwidth to be able to offer these treatments themselves. Again, they can be a screening provider, connect that to one of the treating providers in the network, and we can do that all through kind of this virtual dental clinic that we've developed. So you mentioned that they could email you if any of your attendees tonight want to email you. We would love to set up a time to talk to them, or maybe even host a webinar, kind of a lunch and learn of sorts, to be able to dive deep into this. But we'd be honored.
Sure.
Our goal is to help as many patients as possible get access to these life-changing treatments.
And also the airway dentists are in need, because not every child is a candidate for these Tooth Pillow appliances. So we send them to our airway dentist locator. So for our alumni, you're probably seeing some Tooth Pillow referrals. This is on purpose, because we want you to make sure that you're trained for upper and lower expansion, especially with the children. So it's a circular kind of a system, which just ultimately benefits the patient. So I thank you. Let me just see if there's any.
Yeah. And if I could add on to that.
Sure.
So many of these patients want to also be able to go and see the provider. Again, we can make it and have this be done virtually, but then also be able to go in and see them face to face in their office. So we love working with the doctors that have brick and mortar locations. They can be a virtual treating doctor and overseeing patients, but then those patients want to go in and see the doctors in their office, sit in a chair. And, they might bring their other dentistry to you as well, their cleanings and their regular type of dental work that's needed. But we hear it all the time. Hey, where can I go? Who's a dentist in my area? And again, we're sending them often over to, your directory. Say, find one here. We know that they're trained well. I can't stress enough to everybody on here, like, every dentist should learn how to do these treatments themselves in their practice. And because the patients are demanding it, we don't have to run a single ad. We don't have to do any of that. The patients are telling other patients, and we literally get, thousands of patients coming in to want to get virtually screened on a monthly basis.
Is the Tooth Pillow available internationally?
Tooth Pillow, again, our program, we utilize other available appliances. The Vivos appliances Dr. Ben mentioned, also MyoBrace appliances, or there's other appliances out there. So those appliances may already be cleared in your country. You don't need to wait until Tooth Pillow shows up to your country to be able to do this. Start today, start getting trained, access those treatments, and then hopefully Tooth Pillow will be able to bring our digital tools to just make treating patients more efficient. So don't wait for us. We are expanding. Hopefully we'll be in Canada by the end of the year. We've been doing some pilot program stuff out in Australia. We're expanding and exploring the UK for an early 2025 launch.
Right. Thank you so much, Chad, for joining us. I appreciate
it.
And we'll do a webinar if there's more interest, for sure.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So we have, I love all these questions tonight. There's a attendee with a six-year-old with a severe gag reflex. The parents are concerned that they will not be able to wear the guides. What would you suggest?
Yes, we meet children with severe gag reflexes. And sure enough, when the jaws are too small, there's less room for the tongue. And the less room for the tongue translates into a more significant gag reflex. Your tongue has less room to live in a chamber it doesn't fit in. So your gag reflex is heightened by this smaller space. So that child all the more needs help. It all begins with evaluation. So, you know, we would love to evaluate that child to determine if that six-year-old needs guidance appliance and or on rare occasion expanders at age six. So I don't usually put expanders in a six-year-old, while I know that's possible and we have other faculty members who do teach this type of technique. A six-year-old in my world usually gets a guidance appliance. Because the guide does not take up the tongue space, it just wraps around the teeth. Usually they wear them very well. And for some kids, it just means a few minutes at a time to acclimate. So we might have them put it in, and putting it in yourself is different than someone putting it in their mouth. So we let the child put it in their mouth. And basically we do begin the same way. We're going to do nasal hygiene. We're going to start learning how to clean our nose. We're going to visit the myofunctional therapist because they're going to evaluate the entirety of that child and start working with them. Then we have a guidance appliance that the child may only wear it for a few seconds at a time, but that few seconds will become a few minutes, will then become an hour. And all of a sudden, over time, the good news is we're six, we have time. So we don't have to, by tomorrow, have this in for an hour every day plus overnight. What we would do with a six-year-old that has a gag reflex is set a goal of 6 months. We would be looking for 6 months' time to be able to wear it for 1 hour at a time. And from zero to a few seconds to a few minutes, we would basically be working with that child through the nasal hygiene, the myofunctional therapy, and then the guide to grow to an hour over 6 months. And once we've achieved that, then we start talking about, let's try to wear it to bed. And you'll build on it, but now you're only seven. And we have a long way to go, and we're heading in the right direction. So yes, the child with the gag reflex, we're very interested in helping that child out. And it just might take a little slower approach, but they are a good candidate for it, and we can help them. It just means baby steps. That's okay.
As a myofunctional therapist, how can I connect to airway dentists in my area? I was going to say, start with our airway dentist locator. I think it's airwayhealthsolutions.com/locator. We'll put that in the follow-up email. You can see it at our website, and you can start there. Hopefully that'll be helpful. We have more and more dots every day, so we're really excited about that. But thanks for asking. What TMD diagnosis are y'all typically treating like this? Is it myofascial pain only?
The myofascial pain, headaches, migraine. You can talk about clicking, disc displacement sometimes. And if a patient ends up in my chair with moderate to severe TMD symptoms, I will make a referral to, and my local TMD specialist happens to be Dr. Michael Gill. So I have within 25 minutes of my office the opportunity to send a patient with significant TMD symptoms to Dr. Michael Gelb. And what he will do is he will bring them down from where they are, meaning he's going to have this list of symptoms. They're really struggling. He'll get them reduced to either no symptoms or very mild, but again, in a position where they can then receive orthodontic or orthopedic care. So some of the cases we start with him. He will basically reduce that patient's symptoms to being comfortable enough to receive treatment. Then I take over and do the ortho and get them in a better biting position, an untrapped mandible. For cases where it's mild, if the symptoms in the TMD column are mild, we'll go right into treatment, whether it's removable expanders and aligners or one or both of those things, we'll go right into it for the mild treatment. When Dr. Gelb sees patients in his office for moderate to severe TMD patients, he usually then gets them stabilized and refers them to me for the orthopedics. And we do a very nice kind of collaborative care effort. The myofunctional therapist is almost always included in this. And not to leave out other specialties out there, but body workers, craniosacral, osteopath, chiropractic, there's a lot of people out there, speech language pathology. You know, I tend to shorten it down to boil it because I get told we have 2 hours. And then, of course, I'm trying to teach 8 hours in 2 hours.
I know.
And some I overlook some of the group. But there's a lot of people out there helping people in that natural, healthy pattern, as opposed to just giving them a medicine for something. So we're big fans of all of that group. And we do use a lot of that in a referral basis to help our patients out.
Do you have to wait until age 3 to have a child evaluated? She appears to be class 3.
You don't have to wait to be evaluated because, again, the myofunctional therapy community can work with 2-year-olds. And so, yeah, you can have a myofunctional therapist work almost any age. We know some of them who do that. And so it's not a bad idea to kind of research, look in your area, who can you find that is a myofunctional therapist, start there. And then whether or not you have the right, like I would tell you, if you were in Chicago, you'd go right to Dr. Kevin Boyd. Because a 2-year-old with a class 3, if you go to Dr. Kevin Boyd in Chicago, he knows what to do. He's a pediatric dentist. He's one of my early mentors. He's on our faculty. He teaches all over the world. And he knows what to do with those younger ones. I kind of start at 3. I was never really trained to handle 1 or 2. It's not that they don't need help or cannot be helped. It's just that I don't know what to do with them. So I can work with 3 and above well. But Dr. Kevin Boyd in Chicago, certainly excellent choice for working with under 3. And yes, under 3 needs help, myofunctional therapy as well.
Thoughts on the MyoMunchie appliance? Any thoughts on that?
Oh, anything that helps. Yeah, anything that helps with breathing and musculature, I'm a big fan of. So I would say, yep, that would be helpful.
Right. Let's talk about the hygienist. Can you review the signs and symptoms that you'd have your hygienist look out for? TMD, popping, clicking, narrow arch, vaulted palate. Are there any other signs that we may not be aware of?
Yes. And so even before that, when you first look in, you can recognize crowded teeth is a sign of trouble under developed jaws, crowded teeth, but then recession, abfraction, chipping and wearing of teeth, tooth sensitivity, then anything that is, you know, head and neck related, the facial pain category, the discomfort, TMD or TMJ symptoms that we have. And then you can't even go through a questionnaire with a patient to ask about, are you aware of any snoring? Are you aware of clenching and grinding your teeth? Some patients say, no, they don't grind. Meanwhile, we see the enamel shredded off. So there's going to be an educational, we have to build some bridges because we might see that they clench and grind their teeth. They might not be aware that they clench and grind their teeth. So yeah, there's a lot of things to look for. And it does begin with the teeth because you're looking at symptoms. The teeth, the gum, the bone, all of these things are symptoms of bad breathing, sleeping, thanks to the underdeveloped jaws.
I think we'll have to do a webinar on that as well. A whole webinar on that one. I like that one. Okay. In one of the cases presented tonight, the patient had a fixed palatal expander with brackets and wires on at the same time. Can you please explain how these can work together?
Oh, sure. So while the photos show them on at the same time, it's not done at the same time. So the expanders are first for about 6 months. After 6 months of a nice slow expansion, because I know a lot of people refer to these as RPE, rapid. I don't do anything rapid. So even though it is fixed, it is slow. So slow expansion is our technique. When we achieve almost all of the expansion, we're going to add little brackets on to line up those teeth for the new ones coming in. So we do a fair amount of bracketing towards the end of the expansion, meaning the expanders have delivered the right size foundation. The child is now breathing, sleeping well, symptoms are either gone or almost gone. And then we want to attend to the teeth. So it is foundation first, teeth second. So you have, of course, in the photo series, you're not seeing the entire year and a half treatment, you're seeing it condensed. So you saw expander with braces, but the expander was already fully expanded. So the expander achieves its full expansion, then we can add some braces for some tooth alignment. Once we have that all done, we take it all out and give them a guide because they're only 11. We're going to use the guide all the way through till the rest of the permanent teeth have erupted. The braces, they're very specific. I only use one particular brand. The carrier brackets are self-ligating. The arch wires are broad and wide. They're massive. And the reason I use those is because those are built for an expansive technique after you have a full-size foundation. So I never really use braces alone on any teenager because they have the wrong size foundation. Why would I try to use braces when their foundation is wrong? That model's already been proven for the last 3 decades not to be so good. So I'm not a fan of braces alone. So if we're doing the foundation first and the teeth second, you might need a different braces technique because you have a different size foundation than most bracket and wires are made for. So you need a self-ligating bracket with broad arch wires. So now you can keep your teeth in that beautiful wide position or even make it wider with those. So guess where we teach that? The advanced mini residency, we teach that as well.
Up until what age can you use the upper and lower Schwartz appliances?
So the upper and lower Schwartz, I am going to attach those to being removable. So the removable upper and lower Schwartz, I usually pick up after age 20. and then all the way to pretty much any age. So you can use them into the 60s. I don't do this at 70 and above. I stick with clear aligners there, but into the 60s, you can still use upper and lower removable shorts. We do spend a day teaching that technique. You would slow down, even though it is it's a super slow technique to begin with. It's an extra super slow technique in the 60s and 70 year olds. So you can do it a little bit older, but I do prefer clear aligners in those more advanced years. The fixed expanders I do use through the teen years, and we teach that technique, how to use fixed expanders upper and lower through all of the ages from 8 to 19, because you can use them. You just need to have a good technique.
And time for two more questions. Can you elaborate more about why you do not recommend expanders for faster expansion and then move to guides for the younger kids?
Sure. In the younger kids from 3 to 7, the guides plus the myofunctional therapy and nasal hygiene are so effective that I'm usually trying to avoid expanders altogether. So 3 to 7, we go into guides. I can say in 20 years, I've probably used expanders in the 7 and under a couple of times. So I probably have two examples of using expanders in a 5 or 6 year old. But usually the guides and the myofunctional therapy and the frenum releases are very quick to start to change that child. And so nasal hygiene, myofunctional therapy, and guidance appliances with a frenum release as indicated, that's a big change in a short amount of time. So it's quick enough for me. The symptom relief is right there within sometimes days or weeks. And sure enough, you can be heading in the right direction. I'd like to avoid the expanders if I can. From 8 above, yeah, 25% of the kids get the fixed expanders first. I don't like rapid, because rapid, yeah, you might take the top rapidly to 4 millimeters wide, but if you're not even using a lower one, what good is rapid to begin with? We know the research says it's coming back to the starting point. So basically a technique without a lower expander has already been shown over decades of research to be ineffective with almost full relapse. And so sure enough, if you're going to be expanding both jaws, you want to keep your bite together. So I do give the upper a head start. Let's get the upper rolling, but then the lower goes in a few weeks later and it follows. So slow expansion in my world is more like growth, whereas rapid expansion is more like breaking. I would rather grow you than break you. And why am I racing on the top to get where? I can't go outside of the lower teeth, and the lower is much slower. So even though our technique is upper is slow expansion, lower is extra slow expansion. You have a different type of bone here, but you can use lower expanders for 8, 10, 12, 16 millimeters. Doesn't matter what you need to do. You just have to do it slowly. Have a nice technique, and you can take a child from any number to 40. It doesn't matter if they're 28 or 26 or 16. It doesn't matter what the number is at the beginning. You have to grow those jaws to get to 40 to accommodate what is a normal human being.
What is the benefit of using the guide with myofunctional therapy versus just myofunctional therapy alone from your experience?
So yeah, in my world 20 something years ago, I got started, I got actually introduced to the guides first. And so I kind of learned about the guides, and I used them for a few years before even knowing the myofunctional therapy community existed. I didn't know about it. And so it's one of the most embarrassing things that I did not know this community existed. But once I did learn they were here, we started adding it. Now, sadly, what I had was about probably 3 or 4 years of these guides being used. And that's thousands of children learning, uh-oh, look at what these can do. So I kind of saw, a guide alone is pretty effective. Then I learned, look what myofunctional therapy can do alone. But now you do the two together, and the two together is miraculous. But I know both alone can do wonders for children. It's not like alone is wrong in either direction. So I learned that guides alone, if it's the only choice a child has, it's going to be okay for them. And I know myofunctional therapy, if it's the only thing they get, they'll be okay. The two together, wonderful. So we do recommend that kids have myofunctional therapy in every case. Most parents will do it for the kids, so it's nice to combine both.
Wonderful. Well, I don't have any time for any more questions, because I want to share some exciting updates. I'm kind of going out of my skin here. I can't wait to really share with everybody what we have in store. We're kind of rebranding in a way and offering a little bit more flexibility with our courses by having a fall semester with different cohorts that are structured where we release the course content in a hybrid way and then have the live Q&A, so you can do this at your leisure, at your schedule. You don't have to take off from the office hours, or I know many moms and dads have to drive to soccer practice or whatnot, so you could do it on your own time. And I'm also thrilled to just share with you that Sharon Moore is now on our faculty as well, but I'll dive into that in just a minute. I just want to share our video of what we've been up to. excited. I have about 100 questions here. Welcome, everyone. I am Lauren Gage, your host of this evening's Airway Health Solutions Conversation Series. We have Dr. Michael Gelb and Dr. Lee Martin with us, Dr. Scott Siegel and Dr. Richard Baxter, Dr. Gerald Simmons, Dr. Susan Maples, Darren Moore, Dr. Jivanan Jahandra, Dr. Dave McCarty, Dr. Kevin Boyd, Dr. Brett Christensen, Dr. Jane Bronson, Dr. Steve Carstensen, Brittany Sierra Murphy, with our very own Dr. Ben Miraglia.
Basically, we offer an opportunity to learn techniques that offer growth and development to our patients in any age group. This is also an incredible opportunity for me because not only do I get to meet doctors from variable parts of the country and also internationally, as those doctors come together and we start to learn about our backgrounds and where we may be from different areas, we do come together and have like-minded approaches to treating patients and in delivering care for our patients.
I encourage you to look at testimonials from other doctors who have attended our course.
One thing I love about this course is that I know I can take this booklet to my office manager, show her the codes, I can sit there and communicate with my patients and show them the benefit, and they can actually move forward into treatment. So it's just that simple.
Taking up our proposal to start classifying you as primary care dentists, PCDs. If you have something that fulfills the need of babies, you're going to be valuable and you're going to love more what you're already doing. Just by giving that kid the ability, the structure, so that they can nose breathe as early in life as possible, that is really going to help them.
Excited that our Airway Health movement has really taken flight, and it's all because of everyone in this room. Thank you so much for being here, from the bottom of my heart.
And I believe that there is no room for indifference when it comes to advocating for our children.
So once a year, we gather together as leaders, as mentors, as mentees, as learners at Airway Palooza.
Fun to go down memory lane like that. I appreciate everyone. We just celebrated a big birthday, and we were going to launch this in the summer, but everyone's on vacation and enjoying their life, which is a wonderful thing. So we tabled it to September. But here we grow again. We have more courses coming up. I'm so excited to share with you some of our new courses, but we want to welcome our newest faculty member, Sharon Moore. She's a breath of fresh air and a wealth of information, and her new course is Empowering Change. It's strategies for pediatric behavior and sleep health. So she's really going to focus on the behavioral aspect and how to get that compliance, especially with the younger ones. So stay tuned on that. We have a new course, Clear Aligner Integration Simplified. Everything's going to be launching on Friday. So we're so excited to share that with you. You have 30-day access, and there are live Q&As for each course. So you can have all your questions answered. And if you can't make that particular session, you can join us for another one. We have our mini myology course, which is sold out when we first launched it live, but now it's also on demand with live Q&A. So it's a combination. We're having a brand new course, AHS Foundations of Pediatric Airway Health. We're exploring early childhood malocclusion and sleep disordered breathing. This is an introductory course. So if you're not yet sure if you want to learn how to do it, it's just a deep dive of why you should do it and how important it is for your dental team. So that's an introductory course, and it's really well priced. I believe we're doing it for $4.99, just so everyone gets interested and you can learn more about why you should do it before you jump into the how. And we also have a new course by Brittany Murphy, who just is a brand new mom. So we want to also congratulate her on the birth of her twins, Sierra and Peyton. So congratulations, Brittany. But she, before she gave birth, put a wonderful course together, Mastering Tongue Tie Readiness. It's a 10-step clinical process. Everybody has been asking for this, and it got rave reviews. So please check out our testimonials, because maybe you recognize some of your colleagues as well who are giving these testimonials. Again, they all have live Q&A. I hope you can join us for Collaboration Cures. It's not too late. I don't know if we have last minute adventurers out there, but you can still join us in Reno. And we do have a code LG30 for 30% off of the registration fee. And for those who are going, I can't wait to see you next week. But we do have our Pulmonauts, which I'm a proud band member of. And I know you recognize all of these faces, but we will be at the Collaboration Cure Gala September 13th, and it's almost sold out. So last year it sold out. So if you're going, please join us there and make sure you come say hi to me. We have our Airway Palooza 2025. This is going to be October 17th and 18th, 2025. So not this year, 2025 at the Westin on the beach. And we have our earliest bird special that is guaranteed lowest prices. So we don't say this is as good as it gets. And we offer payment plans. It has been sold out for the last 2 years. So this may be a good time for you to take advantage of that. And we have very flexible cancellation plan. So if you're thinking about going, you may want to sign up for this with a payment plan for financing. We're happy to do that for you. And we have a recap video, but I'm not going to show that today. And the Children's Airway First Foundation are partners of ours. In fact, on our website, if you go to the corner, it's up for the parents. Information. So they have a wealth of information to help you educate your patients. So you may want to take advantage of that. Visit their website at childrensairwayfirst.org. They have wonderful podcasts. The difference is they're geared towards parents and patients. So please guide your patients who are interested, and it'll help solidify your message as well. I'm excited that we're going to have another free masterclass. I promise you guys keep showing up. We'll keep delivering. So October 23rd, we're going to have Dr. Mike DeLuke. He's an orthodontist. He has a wonderful podcast. I know Dr. Ben Miraglia has been on it. The Ortho Coach, or the Doc Pack podcast. I might be confusing the two, but he's a wealth of information and also a breath of fresh air as an orthodontist. And October is actually National Dental Hygiene and Orthodontic Health Month. So I'll be on his podcast talking about all of these hygiene tips that you can do for the screenings and kind of getting back to basics about how we can help from the hygiene chair. So lots of good things coming up. Again, thank you so much for your support. We can't do this without you. We've grown so much because of all of you and this movement. And Dr. Ben Raya, I can't thank you enough for all that you do, my partner in crime here. And the beat goes on, right? We'll continue to show up.
Yes, of course. Yeah, just show up.
Just show up. My famous lines. Thank you, everyone, for your time. We're finished actually 3 minutes early because I gave ample extra time for questions this time around, because there's always so many questions. And we really appreciate all the wonderful involvement tonight and participation. So, Dr. Miraglia, thanks again. Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful night. And we'll see you at Collaboration Cures or in October on our next Zoom meeting. Thanks, everyone.
Good night, everybody.